In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. If you were to keep watch over sins, O Lord, who could stand? Yet with you is forgiveness, and so we confess. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned away from you, knowingly and unknowingly. We have wandered from your resurrection life. We have strayed from your love for all people. Turn us back to you, O God. Give us new hearts and right spirits, that we may find what is pleasing to you and dwell in your house forever. Amen. God turns to you in love. I will put my spirit in you, and you shall live, says the Lord. All your sins are forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ, who is the free and abounding gift of God's grace for you. Amen. We continue with the gathering hymn. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Sovereign God, raise your throne in our hearts. Created by you, let us live in your image. Created for you, let us act for your glory. Redeemed by you, let us give you what is yours. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Welcome to worship for the 20th Sunday after Pentecost.
Today we're going to talk about doing the right thing. The first reading from Isaiah speaks of Cyrus the Persian king. God's people were in captivity in the 500s BC, and it was Cyrus who did the right thing and allowed them to go back to Jerusalem. In the second reading from 1 Thessalonians, Paul is giving thanks for these people who are really doing the right thing in the way they are following the Lord. And in the gospel text, Pharisees and followers of Herod are trying to trick Jesus, asking him, is it right to pay taxes to Caesar? And Jesus shares about what it means to do the right thing. We begin with the first reading.
Good morning. The first reading is from the 45th chapter of Isaiah, beginning with verse 1. This is what the Lord says to Cyrus, his anointed one, whose right hand he will empower. Before him, mighty kings will be paralyzed with fear. Their fortress gates will be open, never to shut again. This is what the Lord says. I will go before you, Cyrus, and level the mountains. I will smash down gates of bronze and cut through bars of iron. And I will give you treasures hidden in the darkness, secret riches. I will do this so you may know that I am the Lord, the God of Israel, the one who calls you by name. And why have I called you for this work? Why did I call you by name when you did not know me? It is for the sake of Jacob, my servant, Israel, my chosen one. I am the Lord. There is no other God. I have equipped you for battle, though you do not even know me. So all the world from east to west will know there is no other God. I am the Lord, and there is no other. I create the light and make the darkness. I send good times and bad times. I, the Lord, am the one who does these things. This is the word of the Lord. And the second reading is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, beginning with verse 1. This letter is from Paul, Silas, and Timothy. We are writing to the church in Thessalonica, to you who belong to the Father of God and Lord Jesus Christ. May God give you grace and peace. We always thank God for all of you and pray for you constantly. As we pray to our God and Father about you, we think of your faithful work, your loving deeds, and the enduring hope you have because of our Lord Jesus Christ. We know, dear brothers and sisters, that God loves you and has chosen you to be his own people. For when we brought you the good news, it was not only with words, but also with power. For the Holy Spirit gave you full assurance that what we said was true. And you know of our concern for you from the way we lived when we were with you. So you received the message with joy from the Holy Spirit in spite of the severe suffering it brought you. In this way, you imitated both us and the Lord. As a result, you have become an example to all believers in Greece throughout Macedonia and Achaia. And now the word of the Lord is ringing out from you to people everywhere, even beyond Macedonia and Achaia. For wherever we go, we find people telling us about your faith in God. We don't need to tell them about it, for they keep talking about the wonderful welcome you gave us and how you turned away from idols to serve the living and true God. And they speak of how you are looking forward to the coming of God's Son from heaven, Jesus, from God raised from the dead, whom God raised from the dead. He is the one who has rescued us from the terrors of the coming judgment. This is the word of the Lord.
I'd like to spend some time with the children now. Kids, today I want to talk about doing what's right. That's so important as you're following Jesus. If you only think of what's good for you, and nothing else comes into your mind when you're thinking about what you're going to do in a situation, it's easy to do what's wrong. Let's say you're in the store and you see somebody drop $10. Whoa! If you're just thinking about yourself, then you say, great, I get 10 bucks. And you grab it and you put it in your pocket, and then that's, oh man, you got something. But that's wrong. If you think about what's good for God, then God is going to lead you to do what is right. And you'll do what is right, and what you'll do is take the $10 and go, the person, you can't get too close in these days, but you say, excuse me, you dropped your $10. And you give them that money, and God through you has done what's right. Or let's say you get some candy. We're hoping we'll get some candy some way at the end of this month, huh? Well, if you're just thinking about yourself and what's good for you, you're just going to keep that candy. You're not going to share it with anybody. You're just going to have it all, and the sooner the better. Well, that's wrong. If you're thinking about what good for God and what God would do through you, you look for ways to share some of that and to be open, to enjoy that with others, and to make it a good time of sharing, not a selfish time of having everything just to yourself. That's doing what is right. God is happy to do what is right through you, and He looks for ways to do that. What you're called to do as you're following Jesus is to look to Him in every situation and say, Lord, show me what's right. I want to do what's right. And then allow Him to do that through you. And you'll have a satisfaction, and you will be able to accomplish things you could never do on your own just by thinking about what's right for just you. Okay? Let's pray. Dear Jesus, we do want to do what's right. And it's hard for us sometimes to know that, what is right. So please, help us when we're thinking about what to do. Rather than saying to ourselves, oh, this will be good for me and that's all I care about. Let's look at what would be good for you and what you would do through us. And then help us to do those things. Show us your way, so that we can do your right and be about your work. Thank you so much, dear Jesus, for this opportunity to follow you and to have you share with us in ways that we could never have on our own. In your name we pray, dear Jesus. Amen. Thanks, kids. I know it can be hard, it is for me, to know always, well, what's the right thing to do? And as long as I'm focusing in on myself and what would be best for me and me only, it's very difficult to get a handle on what's the right thing to do. But if I let that go, God will lead me. He leads you. He'll lead us in the right way. Take, for example, that wonderful account of Cyrus in the first reading. What had happened was God's people had been taken into captivity to Babylon, and they were told there by the Lord to live there during their time of captivity, during their time of exile from the promised land, and to work at building up those people and caring and sharing and being good in that situation for the Lord. And that was the right thing to do. And so even though it was very hard for them, because they didn't want to have to leave home and they didn't want to have to be there, they did that. They worked on building things up and being good among those people. And eventually the Persians conquered the Babylonians, and Cyrus was the king then of the Persians. And wouldn't you know it, because God's people had, by God's power, done what was right, Cyrus knew about them and cared for their situation and worked so that the Jews would be sent back to Jerusalem, sent back to the promised land from captivity. And if they hadn't been doing what was right, what was good for God, as God led them and gave them power and strength, that might possibly not have happened, but it did. And in today's reading, there's a wonderful, almost a song celebrating Cyrus and how God used Cyrus for his good. Even though Cyrus didn't know him, Cyrus was open to doing the right thing And he did the right thing for the Jews, and the Jews got back to the promised land. And that was vitally important for the preparation for the coming of Jesus, the Messiah. And all of that was happening because people were looking to do the right thing, not just looking to themselves, but looking to something larger. And so in the second reading, Paul is writing to the Thessalonians, and it's quite possibly his very first book written in the New Testament. He is writing to this new church, and he has founded the church. He is now wanting them to be strong in the Lord as they are being ready for Jesus' return. And as he's sharing with them, he starts with this beautiful thanksgiving that we hear in today's second reading. And he talks about how they came from their worship of idols and the other things they were doing to follow the Lord. They got beyond themselves and the way they just were curved in on themselves and doing their own thing to seeing the Lord's way for them, and accepting that way, and rejoicing in that way, and following that way, and learning what it was to do the right thing as the Lord guided them and the Lord gave them strength. And Paul says, I know that you have suffered some real challenges because of this, but that's okay, because the Lord is using you for his right, for his good. Trust in that, trust in him, and keep doing the right thing. He will guide you. He will love you through it. And then he goes on to say so beautifully, not only that, but people are hearing about you, about how you're doing the right thing. Those are wonderful stories, aren't they? When we hear a story about how somebody hasn't done what is selfish for them and only focused in on them, but has done something that is caring for others, even if it's meant sacrifice, even if it's meant they didn't get something that they might have gotten otherwise. They did the right thing, and we love to hear those stories and share them, and we hope that we can be a part of them sometimes. And so the Thessalonians were being talked about all over the place about how they were doing what was right and they were following the Lord and the Lord was working through them. And it was a beautiful and it's a wonderful thing, this doing the right thing. And so we get to the gospel text. We're in the 22nd chapter of Matthew's gospel today. And we start with the 15th verse. Jesus is sharing with the religious authorities, and they, quite frankly, are trying to just get rid of him. They don't want him teaching. They don't want him leading. They want the power for themselves. They want the prestige. They want the position. They honestly don't care what's right. All they care about is what they can get for themselves. And they've convinced themselves that if it's good for them, then it is right. And that's a pretty good way to know, maybe there's a problem here. So what happens, the Pharisees met together to plot how to trap Jesus into saying something for which he could be arrested, because then they could get him out of the way. And they sent some of their disciples along with the supporters of Herod to meet with him. And the Pharisees and the supporters of King Herod didn't get along so well, but they banded together for the sake of getting what they wanted, hopefully, regardless of what was right. They just wanted to keep the power and the prestige, even if they were fighting each other sometimes. So it was a nasty situation. And they went to Jesus and said, "Teacher, we know how honest you are. You teach the way of God truthfully. You are impartial and don't play favorites." So they're setting him up. They're trying to really get him in a place where they can trap him. And they say, "Now tell us, what do you think about this? Is it right to pay taxes to Caesar or not?" There's that word, right. Is it right? What's the right thing to do? to pay taxes to Caesar or not. And the way they were going to trap Jesus, they hoped, was that if he said that it was right to pay taxes to Caesar, then God's people would not be following him anymore so much, because taxes were an onerous thing. People really were put down by that method of extracting from them, and they didn't like it at all. So if Jesus supported that, well, he'd have trouble with anybody following him. But if Jesus says it wasn't right to pay taxes to Caesar, well, then they could have him arrested for rebelling against Caesar, against the government, against the authorities. So they figured they had him either way, no matter what he said. But Jesus knew their evil motives, and he said, "You hypocrites, why are you trying to trap me?" And so he brings out just what's going on, and hopefully would make them face it, that they don't care about what's right. They'll say one thing and do another, hypocrisy. They just want to get their own way no matter what. They're doing wrong. That's so wrong. There's no right in it. And so he says, "Here, show me the coin used for the tax." When they handed him a Roman coin, he asked, "Whose picture and title are stamped on it?" "Caesar's," they replied. "Well, then," he said, "give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and give to God what belongs to God." A wonderful, wonderful answer that just goes through the ages with this whole concern about what is the right thing to do. If you're just focused in on what yours is for yourself, you know, whether it's right to pay taxes or not, boy, you're coming up with all sorts of ways to try to keep away from them. You come up with all sorts of things that aren't concerned for others. And it can be a real mess. It can be a real problem. But if you're looking at what's good for God, not what's good for me, but what's good for God, then you're looking at, well, what does belong to God? And what belongs to God is everything. And what the right thing to do for me then is to be a good citizen, to share as I am called to share within my society, to not hoard to myself, but rather to allow for those things that are paid for by taxes and all that is needed that taxes will help with. And this was true in the Roman times as well as today. They had marvelous roads. They had a number of things that were paid for by taxes. There were bad things about the taxes, to be sure. But overall, there were some very good things that happened through them. But you don't pay them or not pay them just based on what is best for you or good for you. No, Jesus is saying, give to God what is God's, which is your whole way of thinking. What is right? What is good for God in this situation? What will help him do good through me? And then you go about doing what he calls you to do in his power, and he works through you for his good. And his reply amazed them, and they went away. This is a challenging time, and these are challenging situations we're in. And we do ask ourselves, what is right for me to do? How can I do the right thing? I encourage you, based on these readings, to not try to figure it out just for yourself and what's good for you, because you won't get there that way. But rather focus in on God. Say, God, what is good for you? What would you do through me? How would you have me respond? How would you have me deal with this situation? And then give thanks that he is giving you the strength, the encouragement, the endurance, all you need to do what is right. And that makes a difference for his work. in ways that you may never know or even understand, but you can trust, because he uses a lot of folks doing the right thing to accomplish what he wants to accomplish, salvation. It is Jesus himself who always did the right thing, even up to and including giving his life on the cross. And because he did that, death couldn't hold him, because he'd always done the right thing. He'd never sinned. And he rose from the dead, and as he has new life, he gives it to us. Thank God that we can do the right thing. Amen. We continue with the hymn of the day. We give thanks today for Connor Riccardi's confirmation. Connor chose to not have the service videotaped, but we were able to confirm him yesterday. We give thanks that he now has given himself to walk in the Lord's way, to look to the Lord for what is the right thing in life. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we do thank you so much for bringing Connor to this point in his faith journey. Bless and strengthen him that he is able now to continue to grow in you, to look to you for what is good, and then to do the right thing in life. Bless and strengthen him in your love. Thank you so much. It is in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. We continue with the prayers of intercession.
Let us pray. God of praise, the heavens and all creation declare your salvation. From the rising of the sun to its setting, may the whole universe show forth your goodness. Raise up devoted stewards of all that you have made. God of all, may your word of justice sound forth in every place. Restore divided nations and communities with reconciling truth. God of light, we pray for those living with pain, illness, isolation, grief, anger, or despair. Join their voices in a new song, assuring them that you call each by name. Living God, as you raised Jesus from the dead, so raise up those who have died in you. We give thanks for their witness, confident in your rescuing welcome for all. Almighty God, you inspired your servant Luke to reveal in his gospel the love and healing power of your Son. On this day, when we give thanks for St. Luke's life and ministry, give to your church and especially this congregation the same love and power to heal and to proclaim your salvation among the nations to the glory of your name. Listen as we call on you, O God, and enfold in your loving arms all for whom we now pray. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always. Let us pray. Holy and generous host, you set a table where we feast as friends. Prepare us to witness to your goodness with every gift you have given us to share, that all people may know your peace through Jesus Christ, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection open to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, In mercy for our fallen world, you gave your only Son, that all those who believe in him should not perish, but have eternal life. We give thanks to you for the salvation you have accomplished for us through Jesus Christ. Send now your Holy Spirit into our hearts, that we may receive our Lord with a living faith as he comes to us in his Holy Supper. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Come to the banquet, for all is now prepared. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. For those not receiving the elements, please receive this blessing. God is with you, blessing you to do the right thing and blessing you through that. Be strong in the Lord. The body and precious blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. God of abundance, with this bread of life and cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. We continue with our sending hymn. Of your goodness.
selfish natures, warmed by you, at length believe that more happy and more blessed 'tis to give than to receive. Lord of glory, you have bought us with your lifeblood as the price. Never grudging for the lost ones that tremendous sacrifice, give us faith to trust you boldly, hope to stay our souls in you. But, O best of all your graces, with your love, our love renew.
Go in peace, serve the Lord.